and then, yeah, spend a very long time updating it. One thing that it doesn't have, I'm going to notice, is numbers. Like, it doesn't tell you how big any of these, pools or clusters or reservoirs are, what their relative magnitudes. In some sense, that's done visually by the amount of space they take up on the page, like, oceans are prominent compared to snowpack. But, you know, if you think about the total stored water on Earth, the ice sheets are the second largest stored water beyond the ocean, and those are quite small. So that's another interesting thing. It's very, you know, it's not a quantitative diagram, it's all a diagram. Good, well, so today we'll start with just a brief overview of kind of the mini refresher on what we did last time. And then most of the day will be relatively, working on the propensity box type activity. So that's going to be kind of our focus for the kind of lecture portion of the class today. And then for those that want to hear the practical portion, we'll work through coding and kind of stream flow and bar charts that I showed yesterday. But it's kind of a mini refresher. So last time we talked a lot about aesthetics and the different types of aesthetics and kind of best practices to use aesthetics. But a review, so aesthetics are how we kind of put data onto different features of a graphic. So common aesthetics that we use are most often position and sort of kind of secondary color. And then other ones that are put in the toolbox are shape, line width and shape, the size of the points. But broadly, your both data and aesthetics are two categories. And the two categories can help select an appropriate one and kind of guide your visualization. Data can be either continuous or discrete. Continuous meaning that, infinitely subdividable into different, decimal places. Whereas discrete means there's a finite number of options to choose from. And then it can be quantitative versus qualitative. Hey, come on in. Quantitative versus qualitative, where quantitative data being of the type that is numbers, and qualitative being text or characters and categorical. And like we talked about, some of the types of aesthetics only work for discrete data. So line type and shape can only be used for discrete categorical types of data, while others work for both continuous and discrete data. So as a mini review, what aesthetics do we see in this picture, or this figure, which is a comparison of a model plus versus what is they, what aesthetics and what data are they going to? Good. Yeah, those are the two big ones. We've got position in both the X and Y dimensions, which are telling us where we call with respect to the model to the duplex. And we've got color, which is an indication of the relative amount of error that we have here. So which of these are continuous and which are discrete? You look like you're about to say something. Exactly. So position is a continuous variable, and it's representing two. The color is being used in a discrete way. So it's changing, here. The underlying data for this color, continuous, is the magnitude of error. But in this figure, it's kind of lumped into these different discrete things. And only those discrete things are being shown. good. I think that some of these EDs, which ones are quantitative and which ones are qualitative. Top part, and if you need to, you can adjust. And again, that's only in an admin thing. You don't want to get into it. So what is this message box? It's a tool that was developed by the organization that put out that workbook there. And it's kind of built around the fundamental concept that at any given time, the human brain can take in 3 to 5 pieces of information. Not very much information. And it helps figure out what those pieces of information should be, depending on who you're trying to communicate with, what's their background knowledge, and what you want to share with them. So we'll briefly kind of go through the different pieces of the message box, and we'll kind of intersperse that with opportunities to work in a more small groups on filling it out themselves. But broadly, it's kind of split up into 6 pieces. The first piece, and the piece that kind of controls everything else, is the target audience. So it's a question about who is impacted by what we're talking about, who cares, basically, or who can change whatever the issue is you're thinking about. From there, it kind of gets into the issue. So what are you working on? You know, someone's searching about your topic, like what are the things that you're going to figure out? And then kind of move from there into more detail. So the problem type, and we're going to go through each of these in more detail, which will help you, is what specific dimension are you kind of looking at? So zooming, you know, from the broader topic of, you know, sustainable water resources, specific topic of extreme events and flooding, something like that. The so what is really maybe the most important piece. What does your audience care about, and why would they want to know this? How does it impact something they care about? The solution piece is what can be done to address this problem, and or how are you addressing it? And then eventually it kind of makes it to the best thing. So who does this help, and how? And, you know, that can be either short-term or long-term, depending on the piece you're trying to get at. So the message box is a piece that's kind of meant to take, you know, your research, messaging, and figures, put it into this sort of coherent narrative structure, and then make it easy for people to understand and ultimately use your work, whether that's the public or the scientific audience. And what we're going to kind of think about in this is how you kind of take, you know, the paper to the message box to the effective visualization technique, which ultimately, you know, would in many cases keep that going and kind of updating the narrative there. So the target audience is the most important step in this whole process. It's small in there, but it's the kind of key piece of determining what all the other boxes are going to look like. So, you know, for everyone here that's working on a research project, who would care about what you're doing?
Anyone?
Policymakers, yeah. Yeah, those are all great candidate groups. So they can range from, you know, very high-level policy to other researchers that are interested in studying catchments or any other thing. In general, this is going to be the most effective type of tool when you're specific about that large audience. So you can really almost put it to the hand. So thinking through, you know, some examples from Orange, Kansas, the public is one option. But a better option would be, you know, oh, I'm going to be at a booth at the county fair this week, like, so the attendees of the county fair. Or, you know, journalists is one thing, but another option would be a writer. very different concern than someone like, for national outlet or something like that. Policymakers came up, that again is a broad group, so it could be the policymakers or it could be, you know, the candidates to the policy making on water resources. Which again, but at sort of a different level, I think entirely concerned with respect to the information we want to go with. So it's really great to kind of think through these broad categories and kind of really try to zoom in. I know researchers came up, and again, that's another area that we can be specific. So if you're saying researchers, that's a broad group. If you're saying, you know, individuals who are interested in catching classification, that would be a more specific group. So all of these are, you know, kind of, you know, it's good to have a general category, but it's better if you go specific about who that audience is and how you can target it. So we're going to start our first group exercise, maybe in groups of three. We can split up and, you know, share. I guess probably at this point everyone already knows your research focus with each other. But if you don't have a specific research project, you can just choose an environmental issue that you care about or you think you might be researching. And just kind of discuss together who might care and then what is the target audience you want to put on your box during that exercise. Yeah, we'll just take a few minutes to do that. We'll come back to share it out. Yes. Yes. Everyone make their own. And you don't have to, you know, be the same target audience or anything like that. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Thank you. assembly before. Identifying target audiences, that's awesome. Let's hear who they are. And we can start in the back with Patricia. Call you out. You don't have your project yet? Good. Well, I would say, you know, if you don't have necessarily a project or something, then you can think about why it is you wanted to pursue that degree. You know, like what's the motivation you have to kind of get out of that. And that might help kind of guide who you would choose for this exercise in target audience. Good. All right. How about you? Great. That's a great group. You have kind of ranging from the policymakers to the people that are living there. For this, I would suggest choosing just one of those. Because the policymakers and the people that live there would not probably have different, you know, priorities and concerns. But I think those are great options to choose from. Good. Under
So when the first talk to the fact change that on water and they do.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Good, that's a great audience. I believe.
I'm very nice lady of work. Maybe she's at the moment in the workshop. I think there is the mayor or the father.
Good, well, it's got a really wide span from high school students to farmers, to mayors, to agriculture departments. So that is, yeah, a great suite of options. Just the individual of those will inspire a choice from you about whichever direction you want to go. Good, well, once that target audience is identified, that really helps kind of make everything else on here kind of crystal clear. So we're going to kind of go through this in sort of this order, but it's not an exercise that has to be done in a specific order. The target audience goes first, and then from there, you know, any kind of box that makes sense to fill in next goes through. So the issue piece is overarching, you know, big picture of what the issue is trying to do. It's pretty broad terms, but again, it would be, you know, accessible and understandable to that audience to identify. So it's a kind of balancing act in terms of how you make this broad enough so that you kind of get your key points sort of encompassed in it, but also specific enough that it's setting up an intersection, you know. So what I mean by this is that you wouldn't want to have it be so broad that it's like, you know, water resources, like something like that, you know, because then there's just so many different directions it's going through. It doesn't give people just something to grasp onto. But it can be a big problem that your work addresses part of. So, you know, to me, that maybe that agriculture is, you know, kind of degrading water quality or something like that. That kind of is a big problem, and you're fitting into one subsection of that problem in terms of your work. So, you know, the example in the book, the workbook, was conserving wildlife photos. So that was kind of a big piece that they were looking at. And then the work that was given an example in there was focused on a really specific subset of that. So from there, we can go into the problem, which is the aspect of that issue that you specifically address in your work. So this is going to be more specific in here, and it's often going to be related to your research function. So it's kind of setting up this next section of what it is you want to address. Often, if you are kind of used to thinking about things as just scientific papers or abstracts or something like that, you know, this is maybe going to be more like the first sentence of your abstract, and then this is going to be more like the second sentence of your abstract. So we were kind of going from zooming out to kind of narrowing down on what specific area that you're dealing with. So the example, you know, again from the workbook was that there's many species of wildlife that are declining, and wildlife don't follow the political boundaries that are placed for, you know, regular plant use or wildlife or something like that on. So there's not a coordination among those different issues. So again, we'll go back into our groups of three. We're not going to do these times specifically, but I'd say like take a few minutes, you know, on your own, work on your issue and your problem, and then kind of share it internally and get feedback from the members of your group. And I'll kind of bounce around.
I'm not far from knowing how we solve this problem yet. This is kind of like a graph on to think about who cares about it. Most people are going to be able to do it.
Yeah, I mean, that's you've got some words in there, try to share them with your group, and we'll come together and have it there.
The
Great, yeah, so it sounds like a lot of kind of specific aspects, what are the causes and you know, potential damages to the problem. Sounds great. Anyone else feel like sharing there? Not yet. That's fine. We'll come back to it. Good. So these two pieces, you know, that we're going to talk about, so the last three we'll sort of go through here. And the so what is really, in my opinion, kind of the hardest one to figure out, which is why should your audience care about what you're telling them? And this is one where you really, you know, want to make sure you're kind of laser focused on like being specific to your target audience. Like what are their interests, what are the things that motivate them? And that requires first learning what it is that your audience cares about. There's kind of this example in the book called the So What Prism, which sort of lays out for lots of different types of groups. So, you know, for policymakers, for instance, do my constituents care about this? Like, does this support my, you know, overarching political agenda? I sort of the key kind of question that I want to go down. For the scientific community, you know, is this like actually meaningful for foundation research? And how can I use it? For more kind of general, you know, public or citizen types of groups, how does this affect safety, livelihood, natural resources, laws, et cetera, just kind of getting into that sort of play. So this kind of so what prism, they call it, is sort of an example of how your message goes in depending on who you're dealing with, your specific group, what kind of comes out as far as the so what. And this process is meant to, you know, kind of give some general ideas, but a lot of times these types of, you know, so what evaluations can happen and do happen through conversations with the people that you're communicating with. So this message box is very much kind of, you know, two ways to speak. You might have an idea as you're coming in, like, oh, you know, I'm thinking about NGO or like environmental nonprofit type of a group, and how to fit an agenda, and then you can go talk to them and you find out actually they have a completely different set of priorities that I envision. So then you kind of refocus and be like, you know, exactly what's going on in here. So the example for from the workbook again was focused on policymakers that were, you know, potentially going to be working on legislation about wildlife conservation. So, you know, the example there for the so what took a financial piece and kind of linked it in to how we can do that. So each year, you know, wildlife doing hunting fishing puts in over $145 billion in economy, and sustaining that industry through wildlife survival depends on having adequate migration corridors. So this is an example. We, you know, haven't had too many numbers in here, but there is a really kind of, you know, jarring or exciting number, something that people can really kind of grasp onto. This is a great place to put something like that. The solutions are where you kind of start getting to what you need to actually solve that problem. So you want to link back to the problems you talked about. You're going to have a strong connection to it here. And try to take it in a direction where you're giving your target audience something that can actually do. So if the solution, you know, is, I don't know, deconstruct the whole capital system, something like that, like that's not going to be a very effective solution for an actionable level for most people. But, you know, in this example, if it's, you should pass a very specific bill to be considered by Congress, the Wildlife Board of the Conservation Act, that's something that the target audience could do. If you're in a position like me, where my job is a geological survey, I'm required to be kind of neutral on natural resource issues, so I can't take a specific policy position like the one that's here. And some of you may end up in positions like that. You can frame this section in terms of action and effect. So what that would mean is, you know, for example, you could say, if Congress passed this act, we would estimate that whatever, $20 billion would be added to the U.S. economy each year. If Congress did not pass this act, we would estimate, you know, a lot evidence. If you do this, this is what will happen. If you do this, this is what will happen. Which ultimately then allows the audience to choose what action is going to take. And then the final piece here is the benefits, which is what is going to come out with all this. So in general, people like to be happy. I do. So it's best to focus on the positive aspects. What are the good outcomes? So, you know, for urban flooding, you could say like, oh, you know, traffic will be disrupted less, or something like that. As opposed to, if you don't do something, traffic will be disrupted more. So trying to put a good spin on things. And to be really specific as much as you can. So there's certain areas of the city, for instance, that are disproportionately affected by it, you know, in city centers, we expect this to change. And you know, to be clear that like all of us are working on projects for different reasons and different skills. And if the work you're doing is just part of the solution, that's okay. You can talk about the bigger picture solutions and you can, and here's how much work is for that. So again, to the example, the workbook was all about reducing collisions between wildlife vehicles. So all examples of good outcomes that can happen if the solution is already implemented. So some general tips on this, just to kind of refresh, is that again, you want to focus on 3 to 5 specific pieces of information. Like when you're done with this exercise, you know, you'll have more kind of bullet points in 3 to 5 in here, but you want to have 3 to 5 kind of messages that your audience is getting comfortable with. You can use numbers, but only in really important ones, and really kind of big ones. So don't get too far down the numeric stuff in here. And to the extent that you can include specific examples of, you know, areas or regions that the audience might be familiar with where the challenges are existing, that would be the best. And, you know, as I mentioned earlier, it's really important to iterate and revise. So when you go out and talk to target audiences, you'll get questions. And you listen to what those questions are asking and telling you, because they're telling you what they care about. So after you kind of, you know, go out, you might revise, so what, you might think about what are the benefits to the discipline, you might think about how the problem differs depending on what you're going to do for people on the ground. So we'll do another session, kind of going out in these last 3 sections of it. And then once everyone's complete, maybe we'll just kind of switch up the groups a little bit, have everyone sort of spin around to the person either in front of you, behind you, and sort of share your whole box with them that hasn't gotten to it yet. And that'll be an opportunity to get feedback on it, you know, share with each other. Like I heard Gabrielle getting good at Evelyn about, you know, other aspects that you might want to consider in there. And hopefully that'll be an opportunity to kind of take this from draft form, basically a year's final product that you know, will ultimately be part of your portion for. So we'll spend a few minutes on that, going through these last 3 sections that aren't complete yet, and then find the person in front of or behind you to share it with. And then we'll come back again. Everyone got a chance to share their yeah.
That's what we just shared our life.
We should explain.
Yeah, you can explain. Yeah.
Thank you.
Oh, you did hear it. This topic is very relevant to one of my projects about extreme events. Like after kind of going to meetings with our kind of stakeholders that are really interested in the project, all the care about. Yeah, I'll have to hear more about what you're doing.
Good, okay. Who wants to nominate one of their peers that they heard that had a really good benefit?
Benefits are the access to water, food, clean issues, education, and good health, aside from a more comfortable weather.
Comfortable weather, I like that. Because of climate change?
Yeah.
Interesting. That's a good benefit. And who wants to nominate someone with a good solution? Yeah, what do you mean by simplicity? yeah, easy to comprehend, easy to see. I think it'll depend a lot on the target audience, but some components of it could be, you know, got fewer variables, maybe there's, you know, four aesthetics you've got and only three of them are important to your target audience, you know, choose off one. Less jargon to make sure the access labels and the annotations are in, you know, user-friendly terms, better not nitrate, setting nitrate instead of enunciate or something like that. Trying to be more action-oriented. So if you are going to try to make sure that there's a solution of some sort, I'm kind of being really clear about, all right, here's the action that you can take, and here's how it shows up on this graph. So a lot of times, personally, I think having annotations on these types of figures is really useful, more so in like journal articles, something like that. Easy to understand the aesthetics. So, you know, sometimes I think like size is kind of a harder one to differentiate. You've got like different size points, but stuff like position, color, stuff that's really quick to grasp and visually apparent. And then there's probably a bunch of those things here in Brazil, the different units, like in science, we use the metric system. In the US, most people in the public don't. So translating, you know, from millimeters to inches in a graph is one kind of easy to overlook thing, but they can just get a lot more understandable to people kind of in different target audiences. So I'm going to show two graphs here. One is from a scientific journal article in the journal Groundwater, so targeted towards, you know, hydrogeological research community. The other is in a report that is you know, put out by the Kansas Geological Survey, more of a public oriented product. And both of them are about what happens to groundwater levels when you pump a well, or pumping a well in the region. But they have very different primary messages. So the primary message of this one here, again, is kind of, you know, technical science oriented audience, is that the aquifer has kind of a two-stage response to pumping, where at the onset of pumping, there's a very rapid decline, and then it kind of tapers off. And when pumping stops, there's a very rapid rise, and then gradually. So from the scientific perspective, what this is meant to show is that pumping, you know, has kind of two distinct stages, and the response to the aquifer to that pump depends on, you know, kind of where you are in each of those stages, and the pumping rate, et cetera. This one, on the other hand, you know, again, change the units from meters to feet, and is plotting for a portion of Kansas, groundwater basis, which is 3, which is in southwest Department of State. How much do groundwater levels change depending on how much water is occurring in the region from groundwater levels? And as you can see, there's a very strong relationship. It's a very kind of simple and easy graph. What I like about it is that it's very solution-oriented, so it's pretty clear to say, if you, you know, even if you don't kind of pick up immediately on what are all the axes and what they're going to mean on there, it's demonstrating that if you reduce pumping by 31%, then on average, your groundwater all will be lost. So it's providing a really clear and quantitative target for the groundwater community in this region that's currently undergoing some. So this, I think, is kind of one example of a good contrast between, you know, same problem, which is how the groundwater levels respond to human actions and groundwater dumping, but a different target audience presenting the behavior in a different way in order to meet the needs of that target audience. So I mentioned kind of the exercise that we'll be doing. The course report is sort of this creating material, which we'll, you know, share in our drafting class on Friday. And what I'd like to do now is spend a few minutes, not long, but just everyone's sketching out on pen and paper, you know, whatever. What's a figure that you could see yourself making related to your target audience, just related to your message box for some aspect of it? It won't encompass the entire message box, all the box. Where is the piece of your message box that you can visually, you know, imagine yourself turning into a draft figure by Friday to show the group? So we'll just spend, you know, 2 minutes out, I'd just like to ask a question on your paper or on your tablet or laptop or something. You know, what would the ASCII do with the data? What would be kind of the data associated with that? And then we'll take a minute and kind of share that.
Thank you.
He's a drawer. We've got a few artists here.
No, so it's a simple method that we need to think of represent. We, at the same time, we need to produce enough water, food, and energy to do it.
Good.
Very much.
Yeah,
time.
Yes. Not red. Very nice, yeah, and you've been, I don't know, you've been on the show for an hour, and you're going bad, I'm just going to put your stuff coming on. Well, sure, yeah.
And,
Thank you.
You got it. Awesome. And yeah, so I got it in there. Perfect. So now that the data's in there, there's a few different ways you can inspect it. The reason you didn't get this little information about the data that came in is because you did read.csv instead of read_csv. They're different functions, but they do the same thing. But if we want to take a little bit more of a look at the data, we can use this function called glimpse. And if you glimpse as a function and stream data to the name of that table we just created as our argument. And this just gives us a little example. Here is what the data looks like. So in the date column, here's the first two values. In the water column, here's the first two values, etc. And the challenge that we're going to run into is right now our date is in character format. What that means is that it's discrete. In other words, the discrete variable rather than the continuous variable that date should be. So what we need to do is convert the date column to a date format for plotting. And to do that, we're going to use a function from the package called lubridate. So in order to do that, we can take some data. To create a new column in the data frame, you use this dollar sign. So we'll call this new one date new. And we can set it equal to the output of a function. And the function we're going to use is based on the format of this input data. And this is in the format that's kind of typical in the US of the month, then the day, then the year. So what we have to do is tell it that format, and we'll use this function called MDY on the day here. And if we then provide as an argument to that function, the date column that already came in there, we'll create this new date column that has our date in the correct format. So we can type this and hit Control Enter to run it. And nothing will happen, which is good. But if we now do another glimpse at our stream data, and we can hit Control Enter, we can see that now we've got this new column called date new at the bottom, and the format it's telling us is in the date format, and we're doubly reassured in kind of the international standard year month date format, and it's not an explicit string. So those are all ways that we know this function MDY is kind of double what we wanted it to constrain the state. So now that we've done our data kind of manipulation and wrangling, we can make the graph. So if we kind of remind ourselves on here of what it was that we're plotting, what we're trying to do is get this plot where we've got the date on the x-axis and the discharge on the y-axis. So that's kind of our goal, what we're hoping to get to. And if we look back at our glimpse that we were just looking at, we didn't know which column we wanted to use there. So we've got our date underscore u, which is our date formatted data, and then our discharge is cubic meters per second. So we can start our ggplot call, and if you'll remember, we first give it the name of the data frame. So that we are calling stream underscore data. And then the next thing we have to do is give it our aesthetic. So in this example, we want to use for our position in the x dimension, state underscore view, the column we just created. And for our position in the y dimension, we want to use discharge underscore CMS, which is the name of the column that has our discharge data in it. And if you remember from last time, if we just run this ggplot right now without any sort of geometry assigned to it, it'll show us a plot that has the correct axes, but it doesn't have any data on it. Because it doesn't know, do we want to make it a point, do we want to make it a line, do we want to make it, you know, some sort of like a ribbon, or what? So to get our line on there, we can use the geometry line, or geom line. So once again, we're kind of adding our components one at a time. So we started by giving it the data in the aesthetics, and now we're adding in the geometry, the geom line. And if we control enter, we can see what this graph looks like. Okay, so now we've got a lot of somewhat unattractive looking graphs that show discharge as a function of state. And as you'll recall yesterday, we kind of talked about the y-axis in the stream hydrograph as being a really important control over what aspects you want to show. Right now, just the default is a linear axis here. So we've got our y-axis, which is the linear expression of discharge as cubic meters per second. But for this data, we're really interested in the world flows. So we're going to want to switch it to a log transform y-axis. So that's the first thing we're going to kind of walk through how to do. And to do that, we are going to add another piece to our graph, which is going to be an alteration to the scale y. So there's whenever you're going to manipulate a scale for an aesthetic that you're using, you always start with scale underscore and then the aesthetic. So we can do scale y, scale x, scale color, scale fill, scale shape. All of these are kind of the ways that we need to work with this. But we'll start with scale y, and because it's a continuous y-axis, we'll do scale y continuous. And we can kind of change both the name of that axis and the give it a log transformation at the same time. So we'll want to give it a nice name. You can do it in parentheses. You can do discharge in cubic meters per second. And then and there is a way that I'm not showing that you can use superscript and those sorts of things. So to get the log piece of it, what we want to do is apply a transformation in scale. So if we look up in our help scale y continuous, we can see there's all these options. And the trans option is the one we're kind of thinking
So the normal trans is identity, which, by which they mean linear, showed exactly how it is. But if we scroll down here to our trans options, and I'll keep it going for a second so you can see it, you can see all the different transformation options that you can do. So we can do an exponential transformation, a log transformation, a log 10, a log 2, square root, reverse, all sorts of different transformations we can do to control how that axis appears. In this case, what we're going to want to do is the log 10 transformation. So if we get that in there, we can hit control enter, and now we can see that our discharge has y-axis of in log scale. So it's now expressing it in, from 1 times 10 to the minus 3 to 1 to the plus 2. It gives us this little warning down here because we have zero values in our discharge time series. The non-trivial stream that dries out, and if you try to take a log of zero, it's negative infinity. So in this graph, it just kind of puts those on the bottom of your axis, but it's important to note that those are actually infinite values. So we've got our y-axis transformed, we've got our y-axis renamed. The other things that we might want to do are change the color of our line to blue, because the stream flow. And our line is blue, the stream flow. So for that, we can add into the geom line section the color equals blue argument. And here you'll notice we're not doing this color inside of an aesthetic. And that's because the color isn't changing in response to any of our variables. We're just saying, for all the lines, make them blue. So if we put that in there and you control enter, you can see that now our line is nice, hydrological, shade of blue. The other things you might want to do are add some more labels. So we can bring back our labs argument that we used before. Provide a title, maybe we want to call it a stream flow, hypergraph. We can add a subtitle, which is maybe like Kansas River, New Orleans, Kansas. And we already changed our y-axis label, but we can change our x-axis label, we call it the date. And we can hit enter and run there and see that we've got our nice looking hydrograph now. Blue colors, a title, nice labels on the x and y axis, and a log transform y axis. So the only other thing that we might want to do here is, the only thing we're going to do in this example here is change the theme of the plot. And the theme, if you recall from yesterday, is sort of the different aesthetic, or kind of, design elements of it. So like the grid line colors, the background colors, all those sorts of things. And we are going to switch it to a theme. There's lots of different options here that you can explore and try that are sort of default and built in. But I would like to just use theme CW, theme black and white. And if we run this, we can see that we've now got the exact same plot, but it just sort of switched the gray background to this white background with these grid lines. And if there's any other modifications we want to make to the theme, for instance, I don't know, sometimes I don't like to have grid lines in my plot. We can add those in as additional calls to the theme. So if you add in another theme layer, we can look at the help to kind of see what's everything that's in the theme. There's all sorts of stuff on here. You can
place we want to get to is these panel grid lines. So if we want to delete those panel grid lines, what we can do is just indeed the panel grid equals an element. That's one. And that'll delete those. And if we then run it, we can see we've got our graph without any grid lines. Good. I'm going to bop around to see how everyone's doing. Number of drying events based on the season and the climate. So this is also data that's in the SharePoint. It's the dry periods underscore data.csv file. So if you just download that to the same spot as your other data, you should be able to work with that. It's derived from that exact same stream hydrograph data, but I just already kind of did that process of steps to convert from the graph step. So I'm going to start a new code file here. And this one I'm going to name dry periods code.r. And I'm going to build a little description, which is just show demonstrated how to use the bar chart showing the mean dry period by season. And we look at adding the class. So data are for the river and Hawaiian USGSH. So this will help orient whoever is in here. Or whatever, whoever else looks at this, kind of what we're doing in one simple. And before I do anything else, I'm going to save this file as well as dry periods code, just so that then as I kind of work through it, I can say periodically if I don't need anything. So the first thing we're going to do before we get into R is inspect our data. And what that means is we're going to look at the file before we load it to make sure we know what to expect. So if we pop this up here, I can zoom in a little bit for you. We've got a computer tablet. So this is a really simple data frame. It's got three columns, which is basically for each time it's being dried. What's the first day that there's a zero value for this chart? What's the last day that there's a zero value for this charge? And then what's the total number of days in that period? So the total number of total days, which could just be calculated, or is just calculated as the difference between the days. So those are our three pieces of data that we have. Now that we kind of know what to expect, we can pop some things on after we prep our workspace. We can load our packages. If everyone should already have tidy versus loaded from the preceding example, but in case you don't, we can check our working directory. So we call them the getwd function for that. So if you get that working directory, it should still be pointing us, unless you kind of save this file in a different place or close it inside our studio. It should still be pointing you to the folder where your data is stored. Then we get into step three, which is to load the data. So what we'll do is we'll call this one dry underscore data, and we'll use again that same the CSV function to open it up, and we can close that. Look at the copy the name over, drag the area of underscore data, and put it in here for our CSV. And if you load it with read underscore CSV, you'll get this little indication of what's in each column. So it should have as the first column a double, so a numeric continuous value. And for first no flow day and last no flow day, you'll notice this time they've already R is already kind of identified that their date for it. And that's handy. Now we don't have to go through that step of maybe we can also inspect the data using glimpse, the dry data, and it will confirm that we've got first couple of days, last couple of days of states, and the total couple of days as a double. So, everyone has data in the once you get to step three, hopefully that's going to take all the time there. And you can also, if you add in the right folder, just type in the name and extract it, and import data back to the entity, and get it from the copy. Good, so now that we've got data in there, what we can do is revisit our intended outcome. In other words, let's look back at the plot we're actually trying to make. So for this plot we're trying to make, what we want is the x-axis to be the season, for the y-axis to be the number of drying events that happen in that season, and then the fill to be based on the mean event. And if you kind of take that, you can put it in there, y equals number of events, fill equals the information. You can see that we don't actually have standard static information in our current data plan. So we're going to have to calculate all that. And what that means is that we need to extract the season for each event and summarize the output for each season. And just for the purposes of this, we'll define the seasons for winter equals January, February, March, so month 1 to 3. Spring equals April to June equals month 4 to 6. Summer equals July, August, and September, month 7 to 9. And fall equals October and December equals month 10 to 12. So the reason we have to kind of define these different seasons is because we're going to have to group our data, group our dry events into them. So we have to know kind of how do we want to define our seasons. So now that we've got a clear vision for what exactly we want to do, we'll do our data software. And you don't need to kind of type all of these notes into your code if you don't want to. I'm just typing them in to kind of help orient us. So the first thing we need to do is figure out for each one of these events what's the month that it happens in. We'll make that month column. And we'll make that as a new column in our dry data frame. What we can call it is the month number. So as a reminder, this dollar sign is how you make a new column in an existing data frame. And we're lucky because there's a convenient function called month that tells you the month for each thing that happens, for each date. So we want to say for all of the first snowfall dates, so for the dates that these events start, let's grab the month out of the data frame and then we can look at it. So if we hit Control Enter here, you can see that it runs. And if we then click on Dry Data to take a look at what our output looks like, you can see that now there's a new column here for the month number. So you know this one happened on April 18th and pulled out month number 4. This one happened on May 13th and pulled out month number 5. So these kind of go into grabbing for the first note that it was the middle body here, month 4. And then kind of the tricky part is we've got to make a season column. And we'll define those seasons based on these kind of month periods that we use here. And there's lots of different ways that you can do this. You can use like a if statement or something like that. The way we're going to do it is one where we'll start out by just creating a new column called season that's going to be empty. So we're going to fill it with NA values. And then we can glimpse that if we want to and see what it looks like. We've got this new season column that's just all in it, so there's nothing there. And then we can use logical expressions to fill in this column. So in R for logical expression, what we want to do for this season column, we're going to use these square brackets to select certain rows in that column. So, if we say we want to take the season column, and for any day, or for any entry in this column, where the month number is in the month 1, 2, or 3, and we want to call that winter. So what this will do is go through, look for every row where the
grow with the value mentioned. So we get control and enter here. We can run that. And we can take a little look over at our data frame, and we can see that all of these ones at the top are still NAs because they are all not in month 1, 2, and 3. But if we get to a dry event that happened in the month 1, then it'll show up as a condition column. So those are the few steps we just did. Who's got an obstacle that they run into?
Minimum quartile, median, maximum, and we can kind of look okay, what's the total range in the flow data? And it tells us that a season is a character vector. And if we look at dry data, we can now scroll through and see that there's a season at all. So now that we've created our seasons, the next thing we have to do is summarize by season. And if you'll again kind of recall what we're going for, we want to get the total number of events in each season, so the number of rows that have each season in them, and we want to get to the average duration of all the rows. So we're going to add a new little wrinkle here. What we're going to do is create a new data frame or a new table that we call dry by season. And this is where we're going to take our original dry data and summarize it. And we're going to use some tools from the package called Equator, which is part of the Hydrologic, to do this. So we're going to kind of introduce a new way of sort of chaining together multiple functions called piping. But what you do is you kind of take your starting point and you sort of pass it down a string a line of functions until you get to your end point. So we want to start with our dry data frame. And then the function that we want to use next is to group it by the season. So we're going to put in a pipe. To do this, the easiest way is to do Control, Shift, and M. And that should create a little something that looks like this. Yours might have percent signs and an arrow instead of this. For these purposes, I think they'll be the same thing. It's just two slightly different ways of how you set up. Yeah. So we'll then take our dry data and we'll pass it to this next function, which is called groupBy. And here we want to give it the name of the variable in dry data that we want to group by. So in our case, that's going to be the season. So what this is doing is taking dry data, it's passing it to this next function called groupBy, grouping it by season. And then the next thing we want to do, we can add another type, which again is Control Shift M. And we want to summarize. And so when we group by the season, we'll then summarize two different things. The first is the number of events. We can name that new variable. What we're doing now in summarize is we're creating new variables based on equations that we get in here, or functions that we get in here. So the function for counting up the number of things in R is just called n. So we give it this n function. We do n, open parentheses, close parentheses. And this will count the number of events in each one and make a new variable in this new data frame called n. And then the second thing we need to do, so now we can use the comma to create a new line, but we're still within the summarize function, is to count the mean duration. So we're going to make a new variable called mean duration. We're going to use the function mean to create it. And then the column that we want to use here is the total no flow days, because that's the column that tells us for each dry event how long is that dry event. So this pipe should be doing kind of three different things. It'll take this data frame, it'll group it by the season, then it'll summarize it as a new data frame called dry by season with these two variables in it. So we hit Control Enter. We can see there were no errors, and we can see that we've got our kind of outputs that we want. We now have for each season, fall, spring, summer, winter. Here's the number of no flow events, and here's the average duration. So, yeah, pop this stack up here, and we're going to do a thumbs up if it works, or a thumbs down.
Got it? Amazing.
Alphabetically, which means we aren't seeing the seasonal progression correctly. Those fall, spring, summer,
Need help? Cool. And that'll be that.
Good. So, we got to do a bunch of things here, and we can just sort of modify our graph as we go. The first and most important one is putting the C's in an order. So, if you have an order, you want to make it what they call a factor. So, we're going to use this factor function as kind of input to our data frame, or into our data plot. And to define this specific order that things go in, you use this levels argument here. So I'm going to start a new line just so you can see, but we're going to say that the levels we want are winter, spring, summer, and fall. The C stands for concatenate. So what we're doing when we do this C is we're putting all of these into a vector. So once we get that factor kind of graphed in there, our x-axis is now in the correct order, winter, spring, summer, fall, but it's got a really long name. So we can work on fixing up basically all of our different visual pieces to make it look nice. So a few things that we might want to do are give our x-axis a 90 degrees. So before you scale x continuous, in this case we're going to use scale x discrete because it's categorical. So our name here will tell us to do the season. Our y-axis, we can, when you scale x continuous, and we can give it a name, which would be the number of events. And we also observe that it has decimals in there, which doesn't really make sense. So we can define where we want these kind of line breaks to be on the plot. And let's say we want to have them, you know, from 0 to 12 divided up by 3. So 0, 3, 6, 9, 12. We'll tell it where the breaks should be using this break argument. And we could do, like we've done before, C, and then put, you know, C, 0, comma, 6, comma, 12. Or we could use this sequence function. that I want to go from a minimum of 0 to a maximum of 12 by 3 every time. So if I just kind of copy this code here, you'll see what this sequence produces is 0, 3, 9, 12. So by giving that, we're telling it where it should be at 0, 3, 6, 9, 12. So if we control and enter, we can see that now we've got those seasons picked up. Our season is in the right order, our season axis has a good name, our number of events have the right grade, and our number of events has the right name. But our mean duration is still kind of crummy, and our fill color is measurable. And we can fix both of those using the scale fill command. And as you can see, like with the other scales that looked at, there's a lot of different options in here that kind of allow you to set your fill in various ways. I'm going to use this one called Veritas, which is a color palette that is just kind of has some built-in color schemes that are nice for visual perception. So it's scale underscore fill underscore veritas underscore c. The c means it's continuous, so there's also underscore d for discrete. And then we'll give it a mean, which can be the mean duration, and of course we need given units of days. So if you run this section, you can see that it's now changed our color to these different ones. We've now got our mean duration at days here, corresponding to the color scale. But because we've expanded this color or fill axis label, things are a little bit thrown off aesthetically. So what we might want to do is put our legend at the bottom. So do that within the theme argument and tell it for the legend position. We want to put this at the bottom. And if we hit control enter, it'll automatically kind of figure out that when you put it on the bottom, flip the scale sideways and get it in there. And if we want to use that same black and white theme that we used earlier, we can also apply that. And so this will give us kind of a graph that we're ultimately looking for. Good. And now I'm going to save the code. So that's our endpoint. So I'm still have that word set, and I can go ahead and got that. I can figure out the room. Good. So the same thing where you need a plus sign after that. So there you go. Good one for that. Excellent. So I'm glad everyone was able to get these plots working.